So in order for innocence to be stolen from another, the person stealing must be doing so knowingly and blatantly with the intent of manipulating another to fulfill his own selfish means, and the victim has to guilelessly trust the person. For example, the leader of a country sends the young men off to a war which also involves murder, in a faraway place, and tells them, "You are fighting for freedom and defending your country," and they believe this lie. So they go to the war and realize in horror that they are slaughtering innocent people and protecting and defending wealthy sheikhs and their oil fields and money, not defending their country's freedom. That is, when their innocence has been stolen from them, when they realize that they have been lied to and used by one/ones they trusted, to perpetrate evil. Another example, say you are a child and you discover that your father has a girlfriend on the side. That is adultery, friends. When you face him with this, he tells you that you must promise him you will not tell your mother. He still loves her and doesn't want to hurt her and the family, etc. If you tell her, she will divorce him and. Well, as a child, you are devastated in your heart, because your father has asked you to lie, but you promised him, and so, somehow, it would be your fault, if you told your mother, and you certainly don't want to cause your parents to divorce. This is emotional blackmail, and the father has stolen the innocence of his own child by making her promise to lie and making her feel responsible for his irresponsible behavior for what could happen if she told her mother the truth. Another perhaps more repugnant example, any adult man or woman who willfully indulges in the lustful coercion and manipulation of a child who trusts him/her to perform any form of sexual activities has most definitely stolen the innocence of that poor child. Here is another example close to the hearts of Americans. Your forefathers of the wondrous United States of America were inspired by God in the development of a most sacred Constitution and Bill of Rights in order to maintain peace and balance and allow you freedom and the pursuit of happiness. Although not perfect, with the addition of certain amendments abolishing slavery, for example, it became the most important and protective set of standards for human rights, decency, and freedom in your current history on Earth. Not every person you elect into the offices of leadership, such as the presidency, vice presidency, Congress, and Senate, has taken an oath to uphold the Constitution of the United States of America. You, the people, have elected these leaders on the trust and good faith that they will honor your Constitution and Bill of Rights. You now have a president, and a Congress who mostly support him, who has essentially nullified this U.S. Constitution by his executive orders in order to pursue the One World Order, which has a new so-called Constitution for One World Domination. This is called stealing your freedom, America, and making you slaves. Are those so-called elected leaders who support this infringement on your U.S. Constitution honoring the oath they gave to you and to God? They are stealing your freedom, and worse than that, they are taking an oath that they know they won't honor. That is called lying to you, the people, for their own selfish means. Please do not confuse the ones who act by willful guile and deceit in stealing the innocence or possessions of others with the ones who truly believe a lie to be the truth and then pass on their false belief to another/others, for example their children or students. This is simple ignorance of truth, and, although it may or may not be acceptable to God, ignorance is not a willful act of stealing the innocence of another. Here is something else that is very important to remember and understand clearly. If one tells what he knows to be a lie in true self-defense, privacy, or for the defense, privacy, and protection of another, this is not against God's laws. This does not mean lying to maliciously deceive about evil secret oaths or activities, such as in the evil cult of Freemasonry. This is one way the Antichrist twists God's laws to condemn others by ones telling you you must never lie, which means, 1. To make a statement which one knows to be false. 2. That which is intended to produce a false impression. You can literally be made the tool for the harm or destruction of yourself or another. Let us give you some examples to think about. Let's say it is World War II, and in compassion you are hiding a Japanese/American family in your basement to protect them from being put in the camps, so the police come to your door and ask you if you have seen or know any Japanese people. Are you going to tell them the truth knowing it will endanger your family as well as the ones you are protecting? Next example, let's say you go to war and are captured by the enemy. They require you to appear on the television and make a statement to your leaders which you know is false, but if you do not, they will kill you. Are you going to do what they ask? Here is an example given several times by Yun. Let's say our beloved Jesus Christ, Sananda, comes to your home and the authorities come looking for him, and you know it is because his persecutors do not want him free and alive. Are you going to tell them where he is? We will give one more example which may become reality for many. Let's say your government institutes a draft requirement. While your son, father, or friend refuses to sign up for the draft and decides to become a conscientious objector. Now, if the authorities call you and ask you where this person is, will you tell them? Now, when it gets a little sticky with God is when, for example, you witness a murder, you know the murderer, and because of your fear of being a witness and perhaps threatened yourself, you lie to the police and tell them you saw nothing. Think carefully about this, because there are crimes committed daily against God's laws of balance of which there are witnesses who are too afraid to tell the police. The criminal remains free to continue his crimes against God. Remember, you must understand the difference. We are not talking about witnessing the breaking of man-made laws, which may or may not be just and change continually with the times. We are talking about the breaking of God's laws which do not change and are eternally the laws of balance within the creation. You ones also have something called little white lie, defined as a false statement made with the intent of being polite or kind. This is also called the social lie. Now most of you ones do choose to politely lie to retain your privacy. This is one way, but there are ways to not lie and retain your privacy as well. For example, if someone asks you how much money you make or what you do with your time, you have several ways to respond. You can lie, or the considered direct but harsh response is, that is none of your business. But for those of you who wish to honor yourself and be polite to the other, you can say simply, please do not be offended, but I prefer not to answer that question, as it does not concern you. There are situations which do fit the criterion of the white or polite lie, although many of you ones do try to stretch the limits of those criterion. The key here is intent. Oftentimes, rather than honoring your true feelings, you will hide behind the white lie in order to keep your job. For instance, if you perceive your employer to be narrow-minded and tyrannical and you are afraid that by being honest and direct with your ideas and feelings, you will be fired. You see, you perpetuate the perceived tyranny against yourself by being polite and allowing it to continue. An example of a truly polite lie is this: when you know your mother spent hours preparing a meal for you, and you do not like ham, and she asks you how you like her meal and you say it is excellent. Although it is not exactly a true statement, your true intent, in kindness and appreciation, is to honor what you know to be her feelings of love for you. So, if you lie and your intent is to manipulate someone in order to selfishly achieve or receive something from them you desire, rather than acting with integrity and being direct, this is not a white lie. Remember this: you can lie to yourself or to another, but you cannot ever lie to God. You see, God always monitors and records your true intent in all situations He presents to you. 10. You must not covet or envy that which belongs to your neighbor. Let us first define the words covet and envy. Covet means to long for something belonging to another. Covetous means excessively desirous of something, greedy. Envy means 1. A feeling of resentment or discontent over another's superior attainments, endowments, or possessions. So the literal meaning of this law is that you must not, because of your own insecure/inferior feelings and lack of self-worth, long to have something another has, such as money, a new car, a skill or talent. And then on top of longing for this object another has, you must not then resent the person who has attained that which you feel you desire, but have not created, exactly because of your insecure/inferior feelings and lack of self-worth. See also recognizing the Antichrist within. What transpires when you become covetous and envious is that you become wrapped up in your greed and resentment, and you will not be taking personal responsibility for your manifested illusion. You will continue to create the perceived lack, and eventually you will be consumed by the effects of covetous and envious feelings, which most often result in the various manifestations of self-punishment, that is, anger, guilt, criticism, jealousy and depression. 11. You must not impose nor force your free will upon the free will of another. Also known as the law of non-interference. This law was given forth by God so that the free will and soul evolution of each fragment would not be infringed upon without permission from God within, especially by the adversaries of God with more awareness of their power,